Series of the prophets, and last week we looked at in the first service. The second service we didn't have a chance to get there, but in the first service we looked at is the message of the prophets relevant to us today. So today I want to continue with Isaiah, and the name Isaiah means Jehovah is the Lord who saves. So who is the prophet Isaiah? It's the major book of the prophets. It's very long, it's very big. Maybe you think it's too big and there's too many details about Ammon, Moab, and this country and this tribe and the wars here and the killing here. But this is a very, very actually important book for you and I, as we will see this morning. Who is the prophet Isaiah? We know very little about his personal life. Very little information about his life. But Isaiah is still regarded as the greatest prophets in the Bible, even though the other ones are great also, but he's greatest, and we'll find why this morning, especially for us today in the New Testament. He received visions from God during the reigns of four kings, and we have the next slide, the opening statement of the book that tells us a lot. These are the visions that Isaiah, son of Amoz, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem, which is the main target of his prophecies of judgments and the restoration of Israel. He saw these visions during the years of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Ezekiah, were king of Judah. And then it seems that he's announcing that his message is for all men over the earth. He's calling people from all over the earth. Listen, O heavens, pay attention, earth. This is what the Lord says. The children I raised and cared for have rebelled against me. So that gives us like the opening statement already. That's the message. My children are rebelling against me. So he's going to address this problem. His visions began in the year of King Uzziah's died. So we know exact timing of his time of ministry. We find it in the vision that he has in chapter 6, verse 1. He recorded the death of the Assyrian king Sennacherib, who had laid siege of Jerusalem. So that means that knowing this fact, his ministry lasted at least 53 years, and probably more, because we know that he, according to tradition, he was killed by being sawn in two by the one of the king of Judah, Manasseh. So that means a few more years after that. So probably his ministry was between 53 years to 60 years of time. That's a long time for a ministry like this. So he has a lot to say. The visions or the prophecy that God gave him were directed to Israel and Judah and to other nations. And according to Jewish tradition, they think that he was from a royal descent, which I never heard about it before. And that he may have been a cousin of King Uzziah, and that may have been given him access to the king of Judah, like because many, he had a direct relationship with many of the kings, giving them message. He actually was called by the king, came in freely in the court, and gave a message to the king. Isaiah was married to a prophetess. You find that in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 3. He had two sons, and the two sons had prophetic names according to the message that he is given. One is Shear Jeshub, and chapter 7, verse 3, a remnant shall return. So even though there are a lot of prophecies of judgments and descriptions and of this, there will be a remnant, and this is clearly announced. God will save a remnant, and he will return. And the second son, Maher Shalal Hashbaz, means speed the spoil and hasten the booty. Means hurry up to destroy, hurry up to kill and destroy and take the booty of the land. So why is Isaiah so important to us? We have another slide here. There are so many things that we could list, so I'm just listing a little bit because we don't have a lot of time. Isaiah is the only biblical book to describe the angels known as the seraphim. We didn't know that, and this illustrates the ministry of the angels, to the believers like us. We learn about the angels, we learn about heavens, because he's telling us about that, and he's describing them in the vision. He's the only one. It's the only Old Testament book to predict both the virgin birth of Christ and the dual nature of Christ in a very clear way. And Isaiah 7:14 in chapter 9, the text that we use for Christmas. It is the first of the two only Old Testament books describing the early days of Lucifer before he fell and became the devil. So without him and Ezekiel, all the theology about the demons, Satan, Lucifer, the evil angels, evil spirits, comes from this book. Without these books, we wouldn't have a theology in the New Testament to explain about Lucifer. It records one of the Old Testament most remarkable and precise prophecy about the Persian king Cyrus and his decree. 150 years before the birth of kings of the Persian king Cyrus even existed, there was such a precise prophecy, because King Cyrus is the one who signed the end of the exile and the return of the exiles to Jerusalem to rebuild the temples. So that's this king. He didn't exist. His name has never been mentioned before, but 150 years before, he already wrote about it. This book contains the oldest, the clearest statement on the Trinity and on the resurrection. So many important doctrines that we know today, and the many of the texts that Isaiah has been writing, John, the Gospel of John, use it a lot. Remember when Jesus talked about the Trinity in John chapter 14? And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter and to come in my behalf. We have the same statement here in Isaiah. And now the Sovereign Lord and His Spirit have sent me with this message. This is a very, very clear about the Trinity and about the resurrection. Because a lot of our theology, we need to understand the importance of that, because a lot of our theology in the New Testament, and that the text, the Holy Spirit who has inspired Isaiah, we can see that this is the same Holy Spirit that inspired the writers of the New Testament, because they are in fact bringing the same inspiration and the same message. In Isaiah chapter 26 says, "Your dead will live, their corpses will rise. You who lie in the dust, awake and shout for joy." And this is like almost the quote that Jesus said in John chapter 5 about the resurrections to righteousness and the resurrection for judgment. And many other writers of the New Testament. Isaiah writes extensively with a lot of details regarding the terrors of the tribulations. He talks not only about the judgment and his time. And this is another thing that we need to understand when we study the prophecies of the Old Testament. Something called dualism. When the prophecies is first, a part of the prophecy is first addressing the event of the time. The political issues, the sinfulness of the time, the events, the conditions of the people. The sins are addressed as they are being practiced in the society of that time. But at the same time, the dualism moves on and give you a future prophecy that will be fulfilled in the future that is not yet approached. And this is because of the misunderstanding of the Jews and Jesus' time about this dualism, that they did not recognize the ministry of Jesus Christ. Because if you read in Isaiah chapter 9, all the names that he will be, his name is Comforter, the government will be on his shoulder, like he will rule, and all of these things. They saw the Messiah as one who rule, and he is one who will rule, but he is going to rule in the millennium. He's going to come back and he's going to rule. But at the time of his first coming, he did not come to rule. He came as a lamb. And another thing that is important to Isaiah also for us is that Isaiah is the only one who describes in this book Jesus or the Messiah as a lamb and as the lion of the tribe of Judah. So he used both figures to bring the concept about Jesus, which is true. His first coming, he was the lamb. The second coming, he is the lion of Judah that will triumph and come. So there are many, many important texts. And the nation of Israel is one of Isaiah's main themes, of course, because he denounced the sin of his people. He pronounced judgment to their generation. He pronounces future judgment that are yet to come, and he announced the Israel restoration. The other slide also gave us some more ideas about why it is so important to us. Isaiah is quoted more than any other prophet in the New Testament. So we have already mentioned that. Psalm is the second most quoted book in the New Testament. Isaiah is the first one. Then it goes to Deuteronomy as the number three. But this is the most quoted book in the New Testament. More than 85 citations of this book and the New Testament. Many of them are repeated twice, but there is distinctively 61 direct quotes of Isaiah in the New Testament, but 85 alluding to. No other book contains as many references to the Messiah as does the book of Isaiah. So it is called the Gospel according to Isaiah. This is one of the titles of the book. Because of the so many passages pointing to the Messiah that is fulfilled in Christ Jesus that we know, Isaiah becomes an undisputable argument for the divine inspiration of the book of Isaiah. But also, this is very important for us because the book of Isaiah is like an undisputable argument for you and me to know that the Bible is not made up by man's creativity, by man's idea. It is proven, it makes a complete divine inspiration, the Messiah. You cannot miss that. You cannot misunderstand that. It is an undisputable argument for the divine inspiration of the Bible. And also, you know that we have also archaeological discovery if we want to go further. And one of the most important archaeological discovery that attests to the Bible, to the inspiration and to the truth and the infallibility of the scriptures is the Dead Sea Scroll found in 1947 in Qumran and Israel. So this is a very important statement, all directly connected to the book of Isaiah. And many other manuscripts, but the most newest one, the most complete one, and we could say more on that subject. Also, Isaiah has been called the Romans of the Old Testament because, like the book of Romans, it presents very clearly from the beginning, opening chapters, God's verdict against sinners. And then it reveals further in the book the way of salvation for Israel and for the world. And the book of Isaiah, like in the book of Romans, God calls sinners to repentance and graciously promises forgiveness. It is no accident that the book of Romans, Paul quotes 17 times the book of Isaiah directly, more than any other writer of the New Testament. I want to give you a glimpse of that. If you go to the next one, I think, yes. In Isaiah chapter 59, I put some scriptures, verse 3 and verse 7, that and more. You have to go to this chapter and read. Actually, you can do it because there is more. And it is a very important chapter for us because we often, when you preach the gospel, how many of us will use Isaiah 59, you know, when you want to explain the wall of separation between God's holiness and the sinfulness of man, and why God is angry with sin and all of this? It is so, so important. So if you look at Isaiah chapter 59, you will find even more than what I have brought. Because of time, I only selected a few. But you will find, compare this text with Romans chapter 3, where it is the verdict of God for the universality of sin, the declaration that all have sinned and fell short of the glory of God, that no one is righteous, no one is good, no one seek God, that all are swift to run to kill. You will find the exact same declaration in Romans as you find it here. And first, the Lord always in the book of Isaiah offers salvation and show himself as the one who saves, the Redeemer. And he says, the Lord's hand is not too short that it cannot save. The Lord can save. The Lord wants to save. The Lord is the Savior in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. And this we must realize it, because we tend to think that the Old Testament God is an angry God that is there only to punish, that's it, and shed blood. And it is not true. This book is filled with revelation attesting to the desire of God to save. But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he cannot hear you. So again, we talked about it last week, because we looked at some chapters of Isaiah and the message last week. And then if you look at the continuation of this chapter, you will see a very strong parallel with Romans chapter 3. For your hands are defiled with blood, your fingers with iniquity, your lips have spoken lies, your tongue mutters wickedness. Their feet run to evil, they have swift to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity, the way of peace they do not know, and there is no justice in their paths. That's the exact quotations from Paul in Romans chapter 3. And this is right there, and this chapter. And then after that, in this chapter, he says, they are like blind men groping in the darkness, and they don't know. They hope for justice, but there is none. For your, verse 12, he says, we hope for salvation, but it is far from us. For your transgressions are multiplied before you, and your sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and we know our iniquity. Transgressing and denying the Lord and turning away from our God, speaking oppression and revolt in this. So the Lord was displeased by this, and that is explaining. But in the same chapter, it says a Redeemer will come from Zion, and to those who turn from transgression in Jacob, declares the Lord. As for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit which is upon you, and my words which I have put in your mouth, shall not depart from your mouth, not from the mouth of your offsprings. There is a restoration, and there is a salvation that is announced in the book. And this is exactly like the same structures of the book of Romans. That's why it's called the Romans of the Old Testament. Amen? If we move a little bit further, this I said that this is the book that has the most quotes of the New Testament. So there's I want to show you a slide, the next one. Just we will not look at all of them, but I want you to be impressed. And that is not even the old quotations of the book. But you can see how important it is from Matthew to Revelation and other books. All the important, these are important quotations that lead to salvation. If you look at the three first one here, is about the virgin birth, the birth of Jesus Christ, the announcement of his birth. Here is the God is angry because they worship like hypocrites, their heart is away from them, and they have turned the house of prayer like a den of thieves, and their eyes are closed, their ears cannot, they worship in vain. In red, I tried to put those that have a direct connection with the ministry to salvation. He anointed me to preach, and we will see that a bit later. Isaiah said these things when he spoke, when he saw me. Isaiah saw a revelation of Jesus Christ and all of his vision. He saw the Lord. He saw we call it an epiphany of the Lord, like the Lord came in a shape that he could recognize him. He's also quoted in the book of Acts, like a lamb led to slaughter. The root of Jesse, the descendant of David, in chapter 11, that's a very, very important chapter talking about the Redeemer. The call to salvation in Corinthian, acceptable time. day of salvation. We quote, when we preach the gospel, we quote a lot of scriptures directly from Isaiah, even though we are in the New Testament. But well, we preach the gospel and we use Isaiah a lot. First Peter, he committed no sin. By his stripes, we were healed. The new heavens and the new earth. This is one of the characteristics of the book of Isaiah. He has inspired many of the vision, and the same Holy Spirit again, John in the book of Revelation has many, many texts and many themes directly parallel to the ones from Isaiah. Isaiah has seen the millennium. You know, the millennium is a very important doctrine for us. Without Isaiah, there would be no understanding of that. We wouldn't know that Jesus Christ is going to reign on earth. There would be a 1,000 year. How the life will be like, the justice, like the wild animals will not be dangerous, and all of these things. And the new Jerusalem and the new heavens. This is unique to Revelations, but Isaiah had seen the visions of these as well. So I want to impart it to you this morning, how the books of the Old Testament that many times we think are too maybe dark or gloomy or long, because many times the chapters are long, and you hear about all these geographical places and the prophecy of judgment about this. But throughout this book, there are glimpses, growing revelation of the salvation message of Jesus Christ and the coming. And Revelation, the Alpha, the Omega, the first and the last, the key of David, he will wipe away every tear, no hunger or thirst. It is all text of Isaiah that you find parallel and the book of Revelation. That is a very, very important book for you and me. Amen? Amen. There are 66 chapters. And this book, and they are leading to the Christ Jesus, the Messiah. If you look at the next slide, you will see example in the Gospel of John. You know, the Gospel of John is a very important book for us in the New Testament. But in chapter 1 of the Gospel of John, and the introducing who Jesus is, already John will use three pictures of directly coming from Isaiah. And verse 23, John replied, and the words of the prophet Isaiah, I am the voice. So he's, the apostle John introduced the gospel, is going to lead to Jesus, but first he needs to introduce John the Baptist. So he presents John the Baptist as the voice in the desert, which is a quote of Isaiah. Only Isaiah and Malachi have this text in the Old Testament. And you find it in Isaiah 40, verse 3. In John chapter 1, verse 29, the next day, John the Baptist sees Jesus walking, and he addresses his own disciples, and he points to Jesus, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is coming from Isaiah chapter 53. Then in John chapter 1, verse 33, John the Baptist is speaking about himself, that how he received his mission from God and how he would recognize who the Messiah would be and how he would be recognizable. He says, I myself did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptized with the Holy Spirit. And this comes from Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, Spirit of wisdom, understanding, counsel, and might, Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And we see a lot of mention also that I don't have time to go into all the details, but there are a lot of mentions about the rivers of living water, that is one of the themes in the Gospel of John, the Spirit of God. John chapter 7, verse 37 and 38, when he goes to the Feast of the Tabernacle at the end of his ministry in Jerusalem, and he says, if you are thirsty, come to me, and rivers of living water will flow out from you. This is taken from talking about the Holy Spirit that would come on us in the New Testament, but it is prophecy from Isaiah the prophet in the Old Testament. So there's so much for us and the New Testament. As I mentioned in the next slide, we see so clearly the prophecy of the virgin with child, the voice in the wilderness, a light in the darkness, and the dual nature of Christ, the virgin birth. Next slide. We see many important quotes in the New Testament, very significant for us. And one of the most significant is when Jesus Christ himself begins his public ministry. And this is how it happens. In Luke chapter 4, he's in the synagogue. He has already started to do some miracles. So people are puzzled by him. They don't know who he is. They know his parents. They know where he's from, but they don't know his divine nature, and they don't know his identity, that he is the Messiah. So Jesus is going to disclose himself, who he is, and he used the quote from Isaiah chapter 61. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor." And then he states the ministry that he's going to practice and the content of the message, the effect of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. And this is the model of our ministry. This is what we are called to practice. This is what we preach. This is like we are the Church of Jesus Christ. We continue to count on the power of the Holy Spirit to go to people who are in darkness and bringing to the light, to open the eyes of the blind, to count on the power of God to work miracles, and to our ministries today. It's the same. It comes from Isaiah. Isaiah in his vision had seen this coming to pass, had seen that this is going to happen. Isn't it exciting to see so many things that you and I, we sometimes don't realize we are impacted by these things. We don't know where it's coming from. We know where it's coming from. The Holy Spirit. It comes from the Holy Spirit. It proves to us, it attests to us in the New Testament, the things that the God had been doing all along. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. And we could go on and on and on and on and on and on, and but I see the time that we have this morning. And let me just close with a conclusion. I'm skipping a lot, actually. But you get the point. And I had so many slides quoting the Old Testament. Of course, the most important is Isaiah 53, isn't it? And I was going to go into that and many other important texts of the Bible for us this morning. Like, for instance, I would just, without looking at it, when John was in prison, he sent his disciples, John the Baptist was in prison, he sent his disciples to ask Jesus, "Are you the one? Or should we wait for another one?" What does Jesus say? He says, "Go tell his disciples what you are seeing." He doesn't quote, but he refers to the prophetic vision of Isaiah. Tell him, the blind see, the walk, the lame are walking, people are being healed, the dead are being raised. Go and just tell him that. That's a quote from Isaiah. If you go a bit further, the book of Acts, one of the texts that we use for water baptism, the Ethiopian eunuch that is coming from worshiping in Jerusalem, is returning to Ethiopia. He's reading the book in Isaiah. There was no New Testament at the time. He's reading what he had. And he's reading it. He doesn't know what it is about. What is it? Is it about himself, the prophet? Is that someone else? And Philip comes and says, starting with this text. And this text is direct quote from Isaiah 53. It is here, like a sheep was led to the slaughter. He did not open his mouth. And this text, and it says that Philip started from this text from Isaiah, and he explained Jesus Christ, the good news of Jesus Christ, which led to his water baptism immediately. And we do the same thing today. This is our gospel. Our gospel that we preach, that we learn from the New Testament, the root of it, the inspiration, comes from the Old Testament. And there are so many more texts that we can learn. In Isaiah 53, one of the most important truths that we need to remember and get it for sure for all of us, we all deserve judgment. God hates sin. God is holy. And God today says, those who practice this sin described in the book of Romans or in the book of Isaiah are worthy of death. But then you find a text of Isaiah that explains what happened when the Lamb of God, the Messiah, came to save. And what one of the things that if you look at Isaiah 53 verse 5 to 8, I just want you to look at some of the underline. For our rebellions, for our sins, for our iniquities, so that we could be healed, he laid upon him the sins of us all, for the rebellion of my people. So Jesus Christ didn't die for himself. He died for us, for you and for me. And I want to finish with some of the greatest salvation invitations directly from the book of Isaiah, that is in for the next, go, yeah, this one. If you look quickly into this one, turn to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. The invitation that God gives us. Come, and I'm really touched by this one, because I think in this text you find the complete gospel message very clearly announced over here. Come, everyone who is thirsty, come to the waters. Also, you that have no money, come, buy and eat and come. Look at the word come, always, come to me. Listen carefully to me. Eat what is good. Let your soul delight itself in rich food. Pay attention to me. Come to me and listen so that you may live. Then I'll make an everlasting covenant with you. Isn't that the good news? Seek the Lord while he may be found. You see, when we hear the gospel message, anybody, when you share the gospel, there is this moment when the Holy Spirit knocks at the door. And he is calling that person. He is pointing to the sinfulness. He is telling them, now if you listen to me, if you pay attention to me, if you turn to me, you will be saved. There is this moment, very special, that anybody needs to answer. They need to say something back to God. Yes, I want, or no, I don't want. But this is a clear invitation of the Lord. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Because you never know if there is a second day. You never know if there will be a tragedy will happen in your life. You never know. And those people who say, I will wait until my deathbed, I can repent. They are fooling themselves, because people who are dying, or they're under morphine, or they are like losing their mind because of old age or whatever it is, they don't have the clarity of mind and the strength, because Jesus says it is by violence that you enter in the kingdom of God, not when you are like just drifting and your thoughts are not clear. It is through a deep, strong spirit of convictions and willing spirit that you enter in the kingdom of God. You say, yes, God, I want to give my life to you. Yes, God, I know I'm a sinner. Yes, God, now I see that you alone can save me. It is when it is so clear and to us that we can. But there is this moment where it says, seek the Lord while it may be found. Call upon him while it is near, while the Holy Spirit is at work in the heart. Let the wicked, that's the repentance part, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous person his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, so he'll have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will pardon abundantly. And that's the God of the Old Testament that is described here. There's one God in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. But in the Old Testament, we see before the Messiah, we see him dealing with sinfulness. And in the New Testament, he will deal with the same sinfulness. And maybe in our modern age, there's too much unbalanced talk about grace, like unbalanced, because the judgment for sin is something serious. God is still holy. Today, without aspersion of sin, there is no forgiveness of sin, of blood. Without the blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. Without holiness, none will see the Lord. All of these texts are texts from the New Testament, but they are coming from the Old Testament. The message has not changed. And the book of Isaiah is one of the most important books for you and I when it comes to understanding more completely. When you when you add the revelation of Jesus Christ to that and what we know in the New Testament, and you put it all together and it attests to us, the Holy Spirit is amazing. Amen? Amen. Let us stand together.